preprint, but it's an archive. It's MFAG 0511 and then something, I don't remember what. But not all of the things I will talk about today and tomorrow, unfortunately, are in this preprint, so some of it is not yet written down. And, well, as Franz told this morning, of course, in mathematics, it's always nice to do things abstractly, but you have to have some concrete examples and some calculations eventually. Unfortunately, in this business, we don't really have many concrete examples, and I'm afraid it will be rather abstract all the way. I hope you will bear with me, and I'll try to at least explain like the crucial points in more or less down-to-earth terms. So the whole sort of goal of the exercise is to generalize something familiar from usual normal algebraic geometry to non-commutative setting, where instead of commutative algebras, we have some algebras which are associative but not commutative. But before doing that, of course, I should remind you about the commutative things which I want to generalize. So, the setting is like follows. We have some X, which is just a smooth algebraic variety. Or some field K, for now, of characteristic zero. Does it work? No? Well, I'll try it, okay, yeah, thanks. Just smooth algebraic variety over a field of characteristic zero. So, we have the RAM complex. Is the problem? Is it better? Well, okay, well, so we have the Durham complex on X, and this is a thing which is defined in purely algebraic way. I mean, you don't need, it doesn't work on you. Okay, I'll try to shout, but. so this is the Durham complex. We can consider the sort of hyperhomology groups of X with coefficients in this Durham complex. And these are known as Durham cohomology groups of X. And it is a theorem of Grothendieck, well, rather non-trivial theorem, that these groups are just as we would expect. So in the case when, say, X is defined over C, these groups are exactly as the topological cohomology groups of X. So by Grothendieck, these are, well, say, reasonable cohomology groups. Cohomology groups. Now, when we have a complex like that, we have we can consider what is called a stupid filtration on it. And we obtain a certain spectral sequence which converges to the Durham cohomology group. And it's called Hodge to Durham spectral sequence. So it starts with HP of X with coefficients in omega Q. And it converges to the Durham cohomology groups. So the main sort of theorem of Hodge theory, in the way formulated by Deligne, is the following. So assume that X is proper, then which to the RAM spectral sequence degenerates. So that in fact we have a non-canonical isomorphism between, say, we want to compute some Duramka multigroup, we can just sum over all P and Q with fixed sum. And this is isomorphic to just Duramka multigroup. Now, there are two proofs of this. One is actually not a proof of this. This is a well-known standard analytic Hodge theory developed in the 50s and the 60s, which actually gives you much more structure of the cohomology groups. For instance, there is some complex conjugation action on it, and there is not just some spectral sequence, but a completely canonical decomposition of this type, and all sorts of other structures. But this statement here kind of extracts everything from the general theory, which you can formulate in a purely algebraic way. So for this statement, you don't need to know what is an analytic space or a C-infinity manifold. This is a statement purely algebraic geometry, which can be proved by analytic means. But surprisingly, there is also an alternative proof, which also requires only algebraic geometry, nothing more. And it has been invented by Deligne and Deluzzi. So, two proofs. First is analytic. And second is the method of Deligne and Deluzzi from, I think, about year 87. So this is purely algebraic. And uses reduction to positive characteristic. This is very strange because the theorem itself, you can just, I mean, all the things here are defined in any characteristic. So you can might just as well ask yourself whether this is true in positive characteristic, and the answer in general is no. So there are counterexamples, actually surfaces, so in dimension 2. Where this thing does not degenerate in positive characteristic. Now the lesson turns out that under some assumptions it does degenerate, and you can use it to prove the same statement characteristic zero. And it is this sort of second proof, which I will try to generalize to a much more unexpected setting, where instead of algebraic varieties, that is topological spaces with sheaves of commutative rings, one has a topological space with a sheaf of just associative algebras of some field. But before going into that, let me sort of briefly tell you how this thing works. There is a very nice paper. I mean, the paper of Deligne and Deluzzi in Invenciones in 1987, it's only 15 pages long. It's really quite a pleasure to read and understand it. I recommend it highly to everyone. There was an earlier proof by Faltings, which was more complicated. And even before that, in the work on crystalline cohomology, there was some proofs also. And then sort of the story developed backwards. So people took a very complicated thing and then threw away all the unnecessary parts of it. And the result is really a pleasure. So let me spend maybe 10 minutes and tell you the main parts of it. So, first of all, they assume that we're given some variety which is defined not over a field of purely characteristic zero, but defined over the width vector's ring of some field of characteristic P. Perfect, or in fact, let's assume it's just a finite field. So K is a finite field of positive characteristic P. And now let me assume for a moment the following thing. So when you have such a variety, and by variety I mean a smooth, flat and smooth scheme, I can consider a special fiber. So this is the special fiber. And this is a algebraic variety over a field of characteristic P. So of course we have a Frobenius map on X. So assume for a moment that this map is actually lifted to some endomorphism of X tilde. Okay, let's be honest and let's put here the twist by the Frobenius of the base field. No, this is the ordinary Frobenius, the pth power. Yeah. Or maybe even better, let's just take here the absolute Frobenius. Just, I mean, map identical on, it's not a map over K, it's just a map which lives in Frobenius of K. And this Frobenius is lifted to some map of X tilde to itself. Now, this is a very strong assumption. I mean, usually if you take some, for instance, compact algebraic variety in characteristic P, you cannot normally lift a Frobenius to such information. But for the moment, let's assume this. And let's look at what Frobenius does to the Durham complex. So as I said, the Durham complex is defined basically over any base without, I mean, doesn't matter what base is. In particular, we can consider the sort of relative Durham complex of X tilde relative all the vit vectors. And since the Durham complex is completely functorial, we have some action of the Frobenius on this complex, which commutes, I mean, preserves the multiplicative structure and commutes the differential. However, one can do slightly more. So notice that let's look at what this thing does on the level of functions. So by definition, if we take some function, then modulo P, we just get the usual Frobenius, the pth power. This map must commute the differential. So Frobenius of df is equal to df to the power of p, modulo p. But this is also zero modulo p, because when you take a differential, p goes to front and thing vanishes. So this is equal to zero modulo p. And forms like these generate the whole model of one forms. So the conclusion is that this Frobenius map is actually divisible by P when we restrict it to one forms. And by multiplicativity, one deduces easily that Frobenius is divisible by P to the power I on omega I. So let's divide it. And these are all flat modules over the vit vectors, so you can divide in a unique way. And we get some map, which for some reasons I will denote as or minus one. So it's essentially just Frobenius divided by this p to the power of y, but now it no longer commutes to the differential because the power is different on different forms. So if you want a map which commutes to the differential, we have to change the differential here. So the target would be just the usual Durham complex. And the source of the map would be the Durham complex, but differential is changed, it's multiplied by P. So we get a canonical map like this. And then effect, which one checks easily, because the effect is essentially local, is that this is a quasi-isomorphism. So the map is well defined. If you want to check whether it's a quasi-isomorphism or not, you can restrict to a formal neighborhood of any point, and then it becomes just a computation about the algebra of formal power series, which is very easy. So now let's reduce this thing back to characteristic P. In characteristic P, we get a quasi-isomorphism. So the target is again just the Dirac complex of xk. And the source now, so we have forms, but the differential becomes zero. So the source is just a complex of trivial differential, just sum over all I of all I placed in degree. Okay, so we have a map like this, which is defined for x over the width vectors and under the assumption that Frobenius is the sum endomorphism. Then one checks, first of all, that if we look at what this thing induces on the level of Schiff cohomology, so we have an induced map, say, from omega I x to the ith cohomology sheaf of the Dirac complex. This is also xk, sorry. Then this map does not depend on any chases at all. Band of chases. And in fact, this map has been known for a long time. It's the inverse to the so-called Cartier isomorphism invented by Cartier 50 years ago. And this explains the notation. I mean, the Cartier isomorphism usually is denoted by C, and this is the inverse one. Okay. But this is not all. So now let us look at the map of complexes. And there the claim is as follows. So, in fact, so the map complexes does depend on some of the choices, but not on all of them. So this first of all, it depends on the variety x tilde over the width, but you don't have to carry think over the whole width vectors. It's sufficient to consider the restriction to width vectors modulo p square. So it depends only on x tilde sort of tensor. This is sometimes called the second width vectors. So this is width vectors modulo p square. And as far as the lifting of Frobenius goes, it does depend on the lifting of Frobenius. Well, again, modulo p square, but only up to a canonical homotopy. So if you have two choices of this lifting, now the corresponding maps are related by a completely canonical homotopy. Chain homotopy in the sense of chain, maps of chain complexes. So, conclusion. Assume given now sum x over the field K of characteristic P, and assume that it's lifted in some way to the second width vectors of here. So it's lifted to a smooth scheme over the second width vectors. Then there exists a map like this, a quasi-isomorphism like this. And the proof is really straightforward. I mean, this X might be very complicated, but we can cover it by a fine open subsets. And the existence of the lifting of a variety and the lifting of Frobenius, these are deformation theory problems for which you can have some abstraction theory. Abstractions lie in some cohomology groups. So if X is affine, then there are no abstractions, everything lifts. So locally, you can construct such a thing. And then because this dependence here is really kind of not so very important. These maps constructed locally will patch together the map on the whole of X. This is crucial. So here the dependence is really important. And if X does not lift to second width vectors, it might happen that there is an abstraction, that such a map doesn't exist. However, this dependence you can get rid of. And it turns out that this immediately applies the degeneration statement, at least for xk, by following a very beautiful trick. So we have a spectral sequence which we have to analyze, which starts from now P is reserved already, so I and J. So this is the Hochstadt-Rahm spectral sequence. However, we can consider a completely different spectral sequence. Namely, our Drum cohomology here is, by definition, hypercohomology of X with coefficients in some complex. And as usual, there is a very standard spectral sequence which starts with sort of local to global spectral sequence. So it starts with Hi of X with coefficients in the sheaf cohomology. And converges to Drum cohomology. So this local to global spectral sequence. And now by using the Cartier isomorphism, these things here we can identify as also shifts of forms. To be completely honest here, I have to consider the Frobenius twist. So it's X with the sheaf of pth powers of functions of the structure sheaf. But this doesn't affect the argument. So we have two spectral sequences, which are completely different. Even sort of the direction of the differential is different. But they start with the same thing. And they converge to the same thing. And by purely by dimension, and all these things, since X is proper, are finite dimensional vector spaces over the base field. And so purely by dimension reasons, we know that if one spectral sequence degenerates, then the other must also degenerate. Because in the spectral sequence, I mean, the dimensions only drop. Whenever there is a non-trivial differential, dimension drops, it can never go up. So we can conclude that, so let me denote this way, 1 and 2. So if 2 degenerates, then 1 also degenerates. But the degeneration of this spectral sequence immediately follows from the existence of this map here. Because essentially this means that the Drum differential is quasi-isomorphic to a differential, the Drum complex is quasi-isomorphic to a complex of trivial differential. and then spectral sequence degenerates for tautology. So the conclusion is that if our variating characteristic P has a lifting to the second bit vectors, then we get the degeneration. And the statement in characteristic P is deduced from this by standard method. So we find a model over some finite type ring over Z, and then we know that at almost all points, the corresponding spectral sequence degenerates by this argument. And then this means that all the differentials must be zero model all primes, so that must be zero. Okay, so this is the end of the commutative part of the story. And now, but the strange thing is that actually all of it can be generalized to the non-commutative setting. So before I sort of start explaining this, you have a sort of right to ask why should you bother? I mean, this is, seems like a rather artificial thing to do. And I don't have a good answer for that. It's just that, I mean, the answer is that it works. So it's worth looking at. And in fact, there are several cohomology theories which work just as well for non-commutative algebras. And maybe the most obvious example of this is the algebraic K theory. If you look at the definition of the algebraic K theory, commutativity is not used at all anywhere. It just, I mean, just the category of modules, that's it. And so it's kind of interesting to try to see what other parts, the homological parts of algebraic geometry make sense for non-commutative algebras. And it turns out that the Dirac cohomology does in some sense, but since this seems like a bizarre question, the story developed over the years very, very slowly. So let me tell it in a sort of historical way. First, we need some replacement for forms. So we need to replace three things, actually, in order to repeat the same argument. So need replacement for differential forms. Second, Dirac differential. Once we get this and this, we can reasonably well expect to be able to state the spectral sequence and state a conjecture about its degeneration. And to repeat the proof, we also need this characteristic P machinery, and the most important thing is the Cartier isomorphism. So this is known since 1962, I think. This is known since 1982. And this, well, I sort of discovered it last year, but in fact, it has been known to topologists for 10 years already. So it's 1995 topological language, and 2005 an algebraic. But to begin at the beginning, let's start with differential forms. So assume given some algebra A over field K, which is associative, but not necessarily commutative. One can also consider a sheaf of algebras, but generalization to sheaves is always completely automatic, so I will talk about algebras just to simplify notations. Then there is one invariant that one can associate to an algebra A, which is very easy to define. It's called Hochschild homology. So what is this? This is a definition. So when you have a commutative algebra, you can consider left modules over A or right modules over A is the same thing. So consider just modules. If the algebra is not necessarily commutative, then you can consider left modules, you can consider right modules, and you can also consider what is called bimodules. That is vector spaces on which A acts both on the left and on the right. So A bimodules, it's also an abelian category. Or equivalently, you can say that these are left modules over A times the opposite algebra. And one example of a perfectly good bimodule is A itself. So what you do, you consider A itself as a bimodule, And you can multiply it with itself. Just take tensor product and take the derived functor of the tensor product, the so-called Thor functors. It's important to realize that this is a very non-trivial operation, even if one A is commutative. Because in the commutative case, if we consider A as a module over itself, then of course it's flat, so there are no higher term modules. But if we consider A as a bimodule, then in the geometric setting where we have some spectrum A, then bimodules are actually sheaves on X cross X. And A itself is the structure sheaf of the diagonal, which is a closer variety. So when you take the structure sheaf of the diagonal and take its store with itself, this is of course very non-trivial. But it is known, at least in the case when X is smooth, and the theorem is like this. So. Theorem by Hochschild, Constant, and Rosenberg. So theorem, Hochschild, Constant, Rosenberg. If A is commutative, and smooth, meaning that the spectrum A is smooth, then there is a canonical isomorphism between Hochschild homology of A and the space of ith differential forms. I mean Keller differentials over the base field. It's important to realize that this is actually true both in characteristic zero, and I think it's also true in positive characteristic, but at least it's definitely true when the characteristic is larger than the dimension of spec A. I mean, the proof is not difficult. You just basically consider the diagonal, and you resolve the structure sheaf by a sort of a Kashul complex. This gives you this answer. Okay. So motivated by this, in general, we treat Hochschild homology classes as a sort of non-commutative replacement for differential forms. Now, as for the Durham differential, this has had to wait for 20 years or so. And then it was discovered by sort of the Durham differential. And was discovered simultaneously by three completely different groups of people. So it was Kwon, it was Ladei and Quillen, and it was also Tsigin and Fagin in Moscow. I think Yuri Ivanovich must have been there when it happened. It was, I think, the year 1882. So. So what these people define is some sort of another invariant of an associative algebra, which is called cyclic homology, or sometimes it's also called additive K-theory and denoted K plus of A. And this is related to Hochschild homology in the same way as Durham homology is related to differential forms. And unfortunately, even now, all the definitions which exist are not very satisfactory from some point of view. So let me give you one of those definitions. And I won't be able to give you a precise definition because there's some formula there which I don't really want to write down. It's the shape of the definition is like this. So we need some concrete interpretation of Hochert homology for this definition. Meaning that when you compute the torus, you generally take a flat resolution and then multiply. And you can take any flat resolution you like. But there is one particular flat resolution which exists for any associative algebra and is completely functorial. So we use bar, it's called the bar resolution. So we use bar resolution to compute Hochschild homology. And this gives us an answer in the form of an explicit complex whose terms are tensor powers of A. So it's A tensor A, two times, A tensor A, three times, and so on. And there is some explicit differential, which you can compute by yourself. So it's called the Hochschild differential. And I don't reproduce it here because I will never need the precise form of it. Now, what these people discovered, in some sense, is that you can do the following thing. You can repeat this complex several times with a shift. So you take the whole thing, then you shift it to the left and downwards. And then you do it again and again and again, up to infinity. And then it turns out that they can write down a different differential also by explicit formula, which goes in the horizontal direction. So that the whole thing commutes. This is known as Kohn differential. And really, I don't want to reproduce this formula for this B because it won't explain anything. So tomorrow, I will give a slightly different definition, which it is possible to write down completely on a blackboard. This is not quite so easy. But anyway, there is some differential. And in the case where the Hochschild-Kostner-Rosenberg theorem applies, so when A is actually commutative and smooth, then let's see what we have here. So this thing up there is a double complex. And if you want to compute the homology, you can first compute the vertical homology. And since we are in the Kostner-Rosenberg situation, we know how to do this. And this gives us just differential forms. So we have A, omega 1 of A, omega 2 of A, and so on. And we have some differential used by that differential B here. And the claim is that in this situation, this B is just a Dirac differential. Just the usual Dirac differential for commutative algebra A. So again, motivated by this, people think that in general, this differential B is a good replacement for the Dirac differential. And the whole thing, one can think of as a certain generalization of the Dirac homology. Well, I mean, this motivated by, it sounds pretty weak. In fact, one can say more. Namely, based on the analogy with the algebraic K-theory. So usually one has a regulator map from K theory of X to some sort of cohomology theory. And this fact generalizes to the non-commutative setting. So we have a map from K theory of algebra A. So here, normally, you have to take some sum over some indices and do some sort of funny stuff. Here, the generalization is completely direct. So this maps directly into the cohomology of the total complex of that bicomplex up there, which is called the cyclic cohomology. So this is the cyclic cohomology. And so as you see that if we compute it for commutative algebra, then it's almost the same as the Dirac cohomology, except that it's the Dirac cohomology repeated several times, repeated infinite number of times. To make the analogy even better, one can introduce a version of cyclic homology which is called periodic cyclic homology. So this whole bicomplex computes cyclic homology. But what you can do, you can also extend this picture to the right. So here we only shifted to the left and downwards. We can also shift to the right and upwards. So this gives you a so-called periodic cyclic homology. I don't really want to draw it on the blackboard. So obtained by extending the picture to the right just as well. And then, this is the definition. I write down explicit complex. And then I say that the total, I take the total, yeah, the total thing, yeah. Right. We have a vertical differential, which is just a Hochschild differential. We have a cone differential, which commutes. So we have a bicomplex. We can take the total complex. And if you repeat it to the right, then we get a periodic thing. And in the smooth commutative situation, if we look at the periodic cyclic homology, then one can see immediately from this picture that this is actually isomorphic to just the usual Dirac homology spectrum of A, repeated infinitely many times, but I prefer to formulate it like this. I take Laurent polynomials with coefficients in these things and in one formal variable of degree 2. This U corresponds to the shift of the whole thing in this direction. Okay. And now, just from this very definition, we get the spectral sequence. And we do it essentially in exactly the same way as in the commutative case. We take that bicomplex there and take the sort of stupid filtration in the horizontal direction. Or alternatively, this is called one of the standard spectral sequences associated with a bicomplex. So it's first term. What is the first term? The first term is obtained by just erasing the horizontal differential. So it's basically a Hochschild homology, repeated many times. This is a non-commutative version of the Hodge to Durham spectral sequence. So this is what it starts with, and it converges to cyclic homology. And analogously, you can write down one for periodic things. With periodic things, you have to be slightly careful because the complex is unbounded in either direction, so there are some kind of convergence issues which you have to address. But let me not get into this. Not really. Turns out to be not important. So we have a spectral sequence. And then a theorem, or I mean, has been a conjecture for some time, and now I want to present the proof of it, is that this thing generates under appropriate assumptions. And the assumptions are more or less the same as in the commutative case. Let me list them. There is no multiplicative structure. No. Yeah, I said that these things work equally well for commutative and non-commutative case, but one crucial difference is that multiplication of forms has no meaning for non-commutative things. So these Hochschild homology groups are just groups of vector spaces, but they are not A modules, so there is no multiplication. For multiplication, you really need to have a commutative algebra. No multiplication here. Of course, I mean, there is a natural structure of a module over K of U on cyclic homology because there is a natural shift operation which acts on the whole complex. And then this is compatible with that operation, yeah. But there is no multiplicative structure. Okay, so theorem. Assume given topological space X with a sheaf of algebras A. Sheaf of associative algebras over some field K of characteristic zero. Assume also that So in the commutative case, we need smoothness and we need properness. So assume that first X has fine homological dimension. This is just sort of a basic assumption. Then now assume that the category of A bimodules also has fine homological dimension. And this is analogous to smoothness because there is a famous theorem of Serre which says that when you have a local ring or general commutative Noetherian ring, then it has fine homological dimension only if it's regular. So in the non-commutative case, this is a natural assumption to impose. And then a third is a version of properness. We didn't really need properness. We only needed that the cohomology spaces are finite dimensional. So we just say that the category of I bimodules is X finite. Meaning that for all L and all bimodules, well, sheaves of A bimodules, the alpha x group between from M to N is finite dimensional over the base field. And then there's a fourth assumption, which is technical. I don't want to reproduce it here. Some kind of finite type assumption on A, finite generator. It only needed in one point on the proof and really stupid thing. Assumption. So these are the assumptions, and sort of the conclusion is then that then the Hochschild spectral sequence degenerates. And so this is the statement. So I want to prove it by a method of Deligne and Deluzzi. I think this has been conjectured by various people, but probably Kantsevich made sort of most precise conjectures and talked about it many times. And he, I think he tried to design some kind of analytic proof for this. But as far as I know, he didn't succeed. And so the only way to do this is to use the method of Deligne and Deluzzi. And even this seems problematic because the crucial thing in the method of Deligne and Deluzzi was the Cartier operator, or essentially the Frobenius map. But if you take an algebra which is associative but not commutative, there is obviously no Frobenius map. If you just write down x to the power of p, then this is not additive, unless x and y commute. Nevertheless, it turns out that some version of Frobenius map exists if we pass to Hochschild homology. And this is the main ingredient in the proof. So let me state today very precisely what kind of Cartier map we have. And then tomorrow I will try to explain how to construct it. So today I give the formulation, and then tomorrow I will try to explain the construction as far as I know. There is no OX. X is just a topological space. Just a topological space. There is no need to impose any scheme structure. But K is a field, so it's defined over K. And in fact, so now I'll state a theorem about the Cartier isomorphism, and the deduction of the degeneration result from this is very straightforward. Well, there are some technical issues, but maybe I will not spend any time on this because this is not so very interesting ideologically. I think the construction of the Cartier map is much more interesting. So let me state this construction. And again, it can be stated for sheaves, but for simplicity, I will stick to algebras. So A is an associative algebra over some field K now of positive characteristic. And let me say that this is a finite field. Probably perfect is enough, but let's just say it's finite. Then, so first of all, there exists a completely canonical isomorphism between. So we take sort of Hochschild homology repeated many times. This is a certain complex, and we take its some ith homology of this complex. And this is isomorphic to ith periodic cyclic homology of A. I mean, you can write this down as a sum of Hochschild homologies of various degrees. So there is a completely canonical map of this type. Second, now we want to lift it to a map of complexes. This is what we had in the commutative case, and this was crucial for the degeneration. So ideally, one would like to have a map just on the level of complexes, right? Sorry, here should be dot. The index is here. So ideally, we would like to have a quasi-isomorphism of this type. This is not quite what happens. Such a map does exist, but it's not a map of complexes. It's something slightly more complicated. Namely, recall that so complexes are essentially objects of the derived category of vector spaces, which is a very trivial thing, right? Some simple category. So have a derived category of K vector spaces. And this is naturally embedded into a much more non-trivial triangulated category, which is the stable homotopy category. Here, surprisingly, we really need to go to things which come from algebraic topology. And this is completely unavoidable. This is essential for the business. This really happens. And this category is much, much larger. For instance, if we take just the trivial complex, just k sitting in degree zero, then here there are no x from k to itself, of course. But here, so let me denote this by I lower prime. And sort of x group from this thing to itself in this stable homotopy category is denoted by st of k. And this is the known as the Steiner algebra. This is a very large algebra. It is known. I mean, it has been completely computed, but it's rather large. And so on. So we really get more exits here. So what really happens is that we really have a canonical, so completely canonical map C, but we have to treat these things not as vector spaces or complexes, but as spectra. So we have to go to this homotopy category. And unfortunately, this is not very useful, at least for me, because I don't know how to work with spectra. I'm not a topologist, so. But one can work around this. So there is this embedding functor, and there is also the adjoint functor. And if we take the composition, so we first embed, and then we take the adjoint. And this is a functor which I denote by ST, which now is a functor from complexes to complexes. So here we don't need any spectra anymore, we just need this functor. And turns out that there is an explicit model for this, which I will use. And instead of constructing this map, which I don't know how to work with, I notice that by adjunction, I can move this to this side, and then all I have to do is to construct this ST, map from ST on left-hand side to periodic signal homology. And now I don't really have much time left, so I won't write this down exactly today. I will do it tomorrow. But roughly, after that, we proceed as follows. This thing is kind of rather large functor, so. But if you look at the homology of this complex, then the size of it is roughly as if it were the product of this thing with the dual to the Steiner algebra. And this Steiner algebra, as I said, it is known. And it is known that ST0 of k is k. ST1 of k is also k. And then there is nothing up to degree, I think, to p minus 1. Well, some degree which depends on p linearly, which is also k, and so on. And what I'm going to use for my degeneration statement, I'm going to use that my A has fine homological dimension, and I want to require that my p is very, very large, larger than this dimension. And then this map here from this rather large thing actually factors through the quotient, which removes all everything here. And the remainder is almost Hochschild homology, but not quite. It's Hochschild homology repeated twice, because we have k here and k in degree one. And so the second claim is that when our A lifts to the second width vectors, then you can also throw away this part, so that eventually we get just a map from this complex to this complex. So if we want, so that statement of degeneration, which I think I erased or something, it was in characteristic zero. And as usual in delinear Lisieux, there is also a statement characteristic P, and there are two assumptions there. So one is that A is liftable to the second width vectors. And second is that P is greater than homological dimension of, say, the pair of x of a. In fact, we had exactly the same assumptions in the commutative case too. This we had explicitly, And this we had sort of implicitly, because when we work with a drum complex, which is made up of exterior powers, we usually tastefully assume that P is larger than the dimension that we can divide by the factorials. We can take the alternation. But in the primitive case, this seemed like a very unnatural assumption, sort of technical assumption. But it turns out that this is really important, and this really survives in complete generality. So these two assumptions are really necessary for the proof to hold. OK, I think this is it for today. So tomorrow I'll give you the construction.